This week on Vaticano, travel to the 2020 Expo in Dubai to celebrate the National Day of the Holy See. Learn about the life of St. Francis Xavier as the church commemorates the 400th anniversary of his canonization. And join us on a journey to the Lenten station churches in Rome. For this and more, Vaticano starts now. The Holy See, the world's smallest sovereign nation, hosts a pavilion on a global level at the World Expo. The 2020 Expo, postponed due to COVID, is being hosted in Dubai with the theme, Connecting Minds, Creating the Future. The Holy See's pavilion focuses on being a place of encounter, promoting the connection between science and faith, intercultural and interreligious dialogue, and human fraternity. 9 exhibits illustrate the Holy See's message of encounter. 3 of these highlight important meetings in history. The central exhibit, entitled The Creation, illustrating man's encounter with God. Then 2 exhibits revealing the importance of interreligious dialogue. The first is St. Francis' meeting with the Sultan of Egypt, Malik al-Kamil, in 1219, and the second, 800 years later, is Pope Francis' encounter with the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, Ahmad al-Tayyib. Both of these encounters paved the way for greater dialogue between the two faiths. The Holy See's pavilion strives to help break down walls that divide and separate people and encourages building bridges that connect different faiths, cultures, and countries. For 170 years, the World Expo has been showcasing monumentous innovations such as the Eiffel Tower and the Statue of Liberty. But beyond these inventions and advancements, the expos serve as a platform of global cultural sharing. Towards the close of the expo, the National Day of the Holy See will be celebrated in Dubai on March the 19th. For many, it was a surprise when Jorge Mario Bergoglio entered the Loggia of St. Peter's Basilica on March the 13th, 2013.
Fratelli e sorelle, buonasera. Prima di tutto, vorrei fare una preghiera per il nostro vescovo emerito, Benedetto XVI.
Not only had his first name and work clothes changed, as Pope Francis, he would henceforth sit on the chair of St. Peter and lead the church. The unique thing about it was that for the first time, there would be another person wearing a white papal cassock at the presentation of the new pope. Pope Benedict XVI had resigned as pope on February 28, 2013, and now watched on television as his successor appeared before the faithful for the first time on the loggia. A few months after his election as Pope, his first trip outside of Rome took him to the island of Lampedusa in July of 2013, where many refugees had lost their lives crossing the sea from the Tunisian coast to Italy. It was a visit with symbolic power. With about 10,000 refugees and islanders, Pope Francis celebrated Holy Mass, spoke out against the globalization of indifference, and called on European leaders to act. Just a little later, the Pope flew to Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, for the 28th World Youth Day, where young people from all over the world welcomed the newly elected Pope.
Queridos jóvenes, cuando vuelvan a sus casas, no tengan miedo de ser generosos con Cristo.
The Holy Father called on Catholic youth to make a mess of solidarity, hope, and faith in Jesus Christ. Pope Francis has continued the tradition of his two predecessors and visited the faithful in the Americas, Europe, Asia, and Africa, encouraging the faithful and urging them to stand up against injustices.
all'inizio non si capiva bene.
While observers and journalists have been at times puzzled over what Pope Francis has meant by certain messages and interviews, his statements on the protection of life are clear and direct.
De dirigirme a la Asamblea General en su 70º aniversario.
For example, in September of 2020, the Pope didn't hesitate to remind the UN General Assembly about the need to protect both the mother and the unborn child, expressing how disturbing it is to see how easy and convenient it has become for some to deny the existence of a human life. Another major challenge of this time for the Holy Father is the fight against the abuse crisis within the Church by continuing the cleansing of the Roman Curia and applying the measures started by Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI.
L'impegno di rendere giustizia alle vittime degli abusi operati dai suoi membri.
9 years since the beginning of his pontificate, Pope Francis' tasks have not gotten easier. Whether it's the abuse crisis, the decline of Christian values in Europe and the Americas, the persecution of Christians in many countries, or the war in Ukraine, which in a sense seems to be on the Pope's doorstep. Pope Francis' voice continues to be one of encouragement and of proclamation of the gospel.
A tutti auguro una buona domenica. Per favore, non dimenticatevi di pregare per me.
Hello, and welcome to this week's Vaticano Updates. Pope Francis said that the Holy See is ready to do everything to put itself at the service of peace. The Holy Father demanded that humanitarian corridors be established for Ukrainian refugees and called the war madness. The Vatican's almoner, Cardinal Konrad Krawiecki, together with Cardinal Michael Czerny, traveled to Ukraine to offer help and show the closeness of Pope Francis to the people. Cardinal Rainer Maria Wolgi has offered his resignation as Archbishop of Cologne to Pope Francis. In his Lenten pastoral letter on March 2nd, Cardinal Wolgi explains that his personal decision developed during his five-month sabbatical, which ended last Ash Wednesday. He reflected on his actions and the situation in the Archdiocese of Cologne, and he said that he is mentally and physically exhausted. The cardinal was unjustly accused with mishandling of clerical sexual abuses in his diocese. Both an independent report with external experts and a Vatican apostolic visitation proved that he did not commit misconduct, but made major communication mistakes. Cardinal Wolgi says he wants to restore trust and hopes that Pope Francis will take the right decision whether to accept or reject the cardinal's resignation. The Vatican's Congregation for Religious Orders has called on all men and women of consecrated life to pray for peace in Ukraine. In a letter released by the congregation last week, communities are asked for unceasing prayer and gestures of peace. The letter states, "Let us pray wherever possible together with our brothers and sisters of the Christian churches and Christian communities, and let us include others in prayer." The Vatican announced Pope Francis will visit the Democratic Republic of Congo and South Sudan in July. According to the Holy See Press Office, the Pope will visit the African countries from July 2nd to the 7th at the invitation of the respective heads of state and bishops. Pope Francis will be the first Pope to visit South Sudan. Blessed Father Titus Brandsma, as well as the two blessed nuns, Sister Mary Rivière and Sister Mary of Jesus Santo Canale, will be canonized. This was decided by the consistory headed by Pope Francis. Father Titus Brandsma was a Dutch Capuchin priest who was murdered in the Dachau concentration camp because of his opposition to the Nazi regime. Sister Maria Ravier is the foundress of the Congregation of the Sisters of the Presentation of Mary, and Blessed Mary of Jesus, born Carolina Santo Canale, founded the Congregation of the Capuchin Sisters of the Immaculate Conception of Lourdes. The canonization is scheduled to take place in Rome on May 15th of this year. On the same day, the French hermit Charles de Foucault will be canonized. Thank you for joining us for this week's Vaticano Updates, and enjoy the rest of Vaticano. I'm Rachel Lanz for EWTN Vaticano in Rome.
After the break, celebrate the 400th anniversary of the canonization of one of the founders of the Jesuit order, St. Francis Xavier. St. Francis Xavier comes to life in a new EWTN docudrama, St. Francis Xavier to the End of the Earth. The screening marks the fourth centenary of the canonization of the two great Jesuit friends, St. Francis Xavier and St. Ignatius of Loyola. The docudrama is produced by Christiana Video in collaboration with EWTN. Written and directed by Daniela Gurrieri.
It was really interesting to enter in the origin of the Society of Jesus, also to understand St. Francis Xavier, of course, the friendship with Ignatius of Loyola. And we decided to reenact also their first meeting, because it is nice to see also the difficulties that St. Francis Xavier had towards St. Ignatius of Loyola. At the beginning, he didn't want to be a friend of his, so he rejected him. So it is nice to see also the work of the Spirit, the work of St. Ignatius of Loyola that he did on him, and how this friendship was born little by little.
I believe that the time has come for me to do the spiritual exercises.
Francis.
This atmosphere of friendship reached beyond the film and also extended to the actors and the crew. Guglielmo De Simone, who played St. Ignatius, says that the whole process was a fun and enriching experience.
It has been a very funny period. Now, during the working week, I could meet so much beautiful people. It has been a very great experience.
St. Francis Xavier was brought to life for the film by Indri Ketesa Shiroka, a young Albanian actor. Indri shares that this role helped him to come back to the faith.
Lord, what do you want from me?
In the years, let's say I was going a little bit far from the faith. And trust me, this movie has made me close to my faith. To my being Catholic, and his figure, has been a guide, a light for me to follow, and I think I will always keep this role in my mind, in my heart, in my body, and in my soul.
The head of the Vatican Dicastery for Communications, Paolo Ruffini, shares that this docudrama is a reminder of the power of the sacrament of baptism.
I found very impressive the words on the baptism, on the importance of being baptized to establish a never-ending link with God. And I think we have to rediscover the importance of being baptized, of being one, and to build the unity of the human being all over the world by conversion.
When he is baptizing plenty of people in India, and that feeling of being so tired, you know, but that which is beautiful, as we saw in the movie, like to be tired about the missionary work, like after baptizing, after bringing the God's word all over the world.
The premiere was held in the rooms of the Church of the Gesù in Rome, which is a very important place for the Society of Jesus and for both St. Ignatius and St. Francis Xavier.
We are very happy to be here because just above us, we have the tomb of Saint Ignatius of Loyola on one side, and opposite there is the arm of Saint Francis Xavier. The rest of the body is in India, in Goa. The importance of a relic is really strong. We have his arm, the arm of Saint Francis Xavier, that through which he baptized thousands and thousands of people. This is why the relic of the arm was brought here. And so it is very meaningful to be here, to have a screening, a first public screening here in Rome at the Jesuits' main church, Church of the Jesuits.
Together with St. Francis Xavier and St. Ignatius, St. Teresa of Jesus, founder of the Carmelite Reform, and a female doctor of the Church, St. Isidore the Laborer, a patron saint of Madrid, and the Roman saint, St. Philip Neri, founder of the Oratorians, are also celebrating their 400th canonization anniversary. When we return, join us on the Lenten pilgrimage of the station churches in Rome.
Welcome to this travel video. We are in an iconic park in Rome known as the Orange Garden. This park is next to a church, the Church of Santa Sabina, which if you had watched previous Vaticanos, that is where the Lenten Station Church's pilgrimage begins. From my experience living in Rome these past 5 years, one of the greatest surprises I discovered initially, and I think many others find too when they come to the Eternal City, is the unexpected number of churches, many times containing relics and tombs of early Christian martyrs. When you visit the early churches in particular, you are walking in the footsteps of early Christians. Amidst all the buildings of ancient Rome, Christians were making walking pilgrimages to these tombs of the martyrs even before the legalization of Christianity. In the 4th century, once churches had been built to mark these places, the tradition of visiting a designated church on each day of Lent began. The exact order of churches was then codified by Pope Gregory the Great in the 7th century. Covering 40 churches in this one video is going to be difficult. So what we've done is come up with a plan to cover as many as possible, as efficiently as we can. Okay, so this is a standard paper map of the Eternal City that you can pick up at the tourist office. And while it's still useful, there are other ways to help us decide how we want to start and where we want to go. What we've done is created a customized Google map where you can find all 40 of them virtually. If you're watching this program online, you can find the link to the map in the description. Let's get this Lenten pilgrimage started. After visiting the Basilica of Santa Sabina, we walk 10 minutes downhill from the Aventine to the Basilica of San Giorgio Alvarabro. Experiences at churches vary when you visit. Sometimes you have the place almost all to yourself. And other times there will be a large group with a mass happening, maybe even with a cardinal. We go next to others within walking distance that allow you to also see places of ancient Rome, such as St. Anastasia, which is next to the Circus Maximus. Then, from the Roman Forum and Palatine Hill, you can visit Santi Giovanni e Paolo, a beautiful Baroque church with Roman houses underneath. Down the road from the Colosseum, there is the Basilica of San Clemente. Here you'll find a gold mosaic of Christ crucified and the relics of the fourth pope after St. Peter, Pope St. Clement I.
Okay, it's a little windy, but thank you for joining us on this tour. As we can see, when you visit these churches, you can design the pilgrimage any way you prefer. You can focus on the churches themselves with extra time for prayer. You can mix it in with a side of ancient ruins, or you can get a feel for the Rome of today.